Health officials are investigating a measles outbreak in western Texas. The state's Department of Health Services.
At least 24 cases of measles have been reported in a West Texas county. Gaines County has one of the highest rates of vaccine exemptions in the entire state.
What's up, everybody? My name is Brandon Hunter. I am a board-certified pediatrician and ICU doc, and today we are talking about the measles. So vaccination rates have been declining. You can see this from the CDC. We dropped from 95% to 93% among kindergarten kids, and this has led to more and more outbreaks. And so I think as a society, as vaccination rates continue to decline, we're going to see more outbreaks of the measles. And it's critical then for parents to become accustomed to identifying it, knowing what symptoms to look out for so they can bring it to their doctor's attention and get kids the care that they need. So let's jump right into it. So initially there's an exposure. A child gets exposed to another child, let's say, who has the virus. If that child is vaccinated, then there's only about a 3% chance that they're going to contract it. But if they're not, that's really about like a 90% chance they're going to come down with it. After the exposure, you have what's called an incubation period, where the virus is in the child's body, but it really hasn't caused any symptoms yet, and so they're really asymptomatic. And then we move into the first part of the illness, which is called the prodrome. And this is where we have fever and the three C's. So you start with a high fever, and it can be quite high. I mean, 102, 103, even more than that. And then the three C's, which are cough, coryza, and conjunctivitis. So most of us know what cough means, but coryza is just a fancy way of saying runny nose or congestion to me. Conjunctivitis means red eyes. The red eyes can be painful, and sometimes it's accompanied by tearing or lacrimation. Finally, you can have some photophobia, so looking into light can cause pain to the child. So anyway, we start off, have fever and the three C's, cough, red eyes, and runny nose. From there, usually 1 to 3 days later, you get to the K or Koplik spots. And so this is actually what we call pathognomonic, or this really just seals the deal on the diagnosis for measles, where if you see these, then you know that's what your child has. So Koplik spots, these are essentially a rash that's on the inside of the mouth. We call them little papules, but they're just little bumps that are 1 to 3 millimeters, and they're usually white, bluish, or grayish with a red base. And you can see them that they often start here on the buccal mucosa, and maybe even like around by the molars, but eventually they spread and they get onto the soft palate and the hard palate. They're not necessarily painful, but again, they really do indicate that this is very likely a measles infection. Okay, so from there, usually 3 days from the initial cough, red eyes, and runny nose, you'll get what's called a maculopapular rash. And this is a descending rash usually, where it starts up on the face or the head and goes down and covers the body. Maculopapular just means that there are some parts of it that are red that you can't really feel if you touch them. And the papular part is when you actually touch it, you can feel a sort of rough bump to it. So we'll look at some examples. So you can see this one starting out on the child's head, and here's some on the cheeks. You can just imagine that some of those look like rough raised patches that you could touch, and other parts are not. One important thing is that when this rash starts, it's what we call blanching. So if you push on it, then you can see like when I push on my finger, all the blood goes out of it and it loses its color. So that's similar for this rash, where at the beginning, here on the child's face, it looks pink, but if you push on it, it will blanch or lose all of that color and then refill. Over time, it loses that characteristic, but that's important early on. Here's just another rash, and then this is the descending rash on the body, and it can be quite severe. In fact, the degree of rash often correlates with how severe the child's infection is and how bad the symptoms are. So if you go to your doctor with these symptoms, they'll often test for it. And there are a number of different ways, but a PCR, which is similar to the way we detect other viruses from a nose or throat swab, is most likely, but they can also detect it in the blood or the urine. For children who have severe disease, it's kind of interesting treatment actually. So vitamin A has actually been shown to reduce the duration and severity of symptoms in children, so it's often used. There's another medicine called ribavirin, which isn't particularly directed at measles, but can be used in severe cases as well. And then finally, you know, if you go back actually before the child has symptoms and say they're unvaccinated and they get exposed to someone that you know has the measles, say they have those symptoms that we described, then you can actually do what's called post-exposure prophylaxis, where you say, hey, my kid is not vaccinated. They have a high chance of contracting the measles, but I need to get them vaccinated now. You can actually do that pretty quickly after. And there's some evidence that it will decrease the severity of the symptoms or potentially prevent the illness. So measles can be serious if your child gets it. You know, about 1 in 5 people who get measles will be hospitalized. And then there are some complications just to know about. So 1 in 1,000 will get what's called encephalitis. And this is basically just where the virus is in the brain tissue, and it causes altered mental status, confusion, headache, and seizures. Many children will recover from that without deficits, but that's always a possibility when this occurs. And then important to say, you know, 1 to 3 out of every 1,000 children who become infected with the measles will die from respiratory or neurologic complications. And then the final thing that's noted on the slide here is what's called subacute sclerosing panencephalitis. This is quite rare, but when it occurs related to measles, it's a truly, truly devastating disease that results in essentially regression, neurodegeneration, and eventually death. So hopefully, you know, that wasn't meant to be scary or anything like that, but for me, it's a motivator to encourage vaccination to make sure we don't go back to the pre-1963 era where we would see 500,000 cases of measles every year, 400 to 500 deaths, 50,000 hospitalizations. So hopefully this is motivating and you learned something and will help you keep your kids safe. If you did, you know, please like and subscribe and then leave a comment below as always to clarify any questions. Thanks.